Okay, so one of the biggest problems that you can face in RAG issues is what are you exactly bringing back from the retriever and how useful is that to the language model overall for finding the particular answer that you want? So the challenge here can be that you bring back a few things and some of them are useful and some of them aren't. Or you can often bring back large chunks and only very small amounts in that chunk are actually useful to the overall answer. So this can be where a particular question is going to require facts from multiple chunks and it needs to synthesize them together. It can also just be for clarity on questions where you don't want other facts getting into your in-context learning window there with the actual query. So this is where we introduce contextual compression and filters. So the idea with contextual compression is that we have some kind of base retriever that goes and gets a bunch of different pieces of information. And then we have these document compressors and filters, which go through and process that information to extract out only what is useful to answer the question. So this could be, for example, where if you've got, you know, a bunch of the information that's needed is in the middle of a particular document that's being returned, the compressor can wipe out, you know, what actually is at the start and at the end of that and just extract out the information for that. And the idea here is that your compressor, or often a compressor pipeline of doing multiple things, is going to sort of clean up those documents and give just the most useful stuff to the model at the end to be able to answer the particular query as it goes through. So with these, you always start with some kind of base retriever, and then you add on some sort of filter as part of the compressor in here. So one of the first ones that can be is just simply a call to a large language model that can be an LLM chain extractor. And the idea there is that it's going to basically use a language model to extract out and clean up the bits before you pass it along. Now, this doesn't have to be the same language model as you use for the final answer. You could actually fine-tune a model to do this particular task. I've seen examples where people have fine-tuned models to extract information out of emails. So where they, you know, disregard the simple things like, you know, hello, how are you, that kind of stuff. And it just gets to the meat of the email and puts that in and then tags that. This is one of the key sort of features that you can do with fine tuning is make a fine tuned language model for a very specific task. And it turns out, you know, that these kind of things work very well when you fine tune for a particular task like that. Another example of a compressor filter is just to have the language model look at each of the responses and see should this go in or not. So often this will be at the start of your pipeline for these. Another thing is that once you've started to manipulate the outputs, you then may want to take an embedding again. So you've got your original query, which you did an embedding to get the information out. Now that you've run it through a compressor pipeline, you then can often take another embedding filter at the end to see, okay, out of these final ones, how many are actually really still close to the query in this case? So one of the key things here is that this allows you to get often larger amounts of documents, bring them back, filter them through, and then sort of compress the information in a way that can send to your final language model call with the query to get the answer back here. All right, let's jump into the code and have a look at how these actually work. Okay, so here I'm just setting up some standard LangChain stuff. We're setting up the BG embeddings, etc., that we're going to go through. So first off, we're going to have some simple imports where we're going to basically just set up FICE for this. We're going to set up a text splitter. In this case, I'm actually going to use the BGE embeddings locally to do this. That makes it quite easy. I'm going to bring in my documents, et cetera. I'm going to split them up. We can then basically just set up a simple little helper function for looking at what we get when we do a search on these documents. So you can see, start off, I'm going to use the same question and ask it, what is Langsmith? And you can see here, I'm getting four different contexts back. And there's definitely stuff that's relevant in here, but there's also a lot of stuff that's not relevant in here. Or it could be, certainly be less verbose in the way that it's got different stuff back. So the first one we're going to do is we're going to look at adding a contextual compression with LLM chain extractor. So this one is basically just setting up an LLM chain. And what the chain is going to do is, in fact, we can just look at the prompt, right? We can see that the prompt is going to say, given the following question and context, extract any part of the context as is that is relevant to the answer to the question. If none of the context is relevant, return no output. Do not edit the extracted parts of the content. So we're basically just asking it to rewrite, or actually not even rewrite, we're asking it to trim off sort of the irrelevant parts and just extract the parts that are useful to us. So you can see after we run this, we ask what is Langsmith, we can see, you know, we're getting stuff that is much shorter than what we had earlier on. Now we've got announcing Langsmith, a unified platform for debugging, testing, evaluating. You can also see that we've gone from 4 documents down to 3 here. So this is the first one. Now this requires another call to your large language model. So sometimes it can slow things down, but it's probably going to give you much better quality of getting the actual outputs out. The next one I want to look at is a filter. So this one, the LLM chain filter, I think the best way to think of this is just like a yes, no kind of thing. So the idea here with this one is if we look at the prompt again, this is again going through a large language model. If we look at the prompt, we can see that it's saying, given the following question and context, return yes if the context is relevant to the question and no if it's not. So what it's going to do is basically go through and decide, okay, this one is a relevant one, this one is not a relevant one as it goes through this. So this allows us then to basically work out that, oh yeah, okay, this bit is relevant. Now notice that this URL and title got trimmed up in this one because it wasn't kind of the most, you know, the best part of it for answering the question. But certainly the announcing Langsmith unified platform for debugging testing was relevant, right? And we can see that here too, right? That this time we've got the full part of that context, but we can see that, you know, that certainly is a relevant thing to answer in here. So this would have been returned yes, and these other ones would have been returned yes. Another trick that you can do is an embeddings filter. So here, looking at this is where you basically do your retrieval first, and ideally you want to do, I'll probably talk about this in another video, but you want to do retrievals of sort of 5 contexts or more sometimes. Maybe you're going to retrieve 5 from different sources to bring back together. But here what we can do is we can use an embedding filter to actually grade these or to sort of like pick the top ones and rank them. One of the things that you may ask is, okay, well, wasn't I already using embeddings to actually get the context in the first place? Yes, you may use different embeddings for this. So I could be using BGE for one thing and then OpenAI for another thing, or I could still use the same embeddings, but you'll see that I could put this in a pipeline. So when we do the actual context retrieval, we're doing the embeddings and we're retrieving the most similar context to bring back here. If we were then to say run this, you'll see in a second that when we run things in pipelines, this is where things start to change. And so if we were to run the extractor first and then create these new ones where we've got, you know, this being chopped off like we saw before, and then we can now take a new embedding on what comes back and see, okay, what are the really good ones in here based on this new embedding that we've got going on in here? So this is something where we can set a similarity threshold. We can go through it. We can basically do a new sort of embedding lookup to return stuff. Okay, next up is where we can start to join all these together. So this is a document compressor pipeline. So the idea here is that we can do a whole bunch of different things and stick them in a pipeline. So we can get our context back. And then if those contexts were, say, 1,000 or 2,000, et cetera, and we want to split them, we can then come into here, do a splitter on these again, split them up from being 1,000 now to multiple chunks of 300. We could put in an overlap in there would be good as well. And then once we've done that, we can have this pipeline that's going to basically do the splitting. Then we're going to do a new embedding filter to see, you know, which ones of these are redundant that we should just chuck away. And then we're going to then basically finally bring back just the relevant ones within a similarity threshold. So this would allow us to say, take five 1,000 character chunks back that we get, split each of those up into 300. So let's say we've got some overlap in there. We're going to get maybe four chunks out of each of those. So we've now gone from five chunks to 20 chunks. And then those chunks are going to be smaller. And then we will take the embeddings of those chunks to bring back the most relevant information for that. And you'll see that when we run that through, now it's going to basically split these things up and bring them back from what we've got there. We could also, though, do something like this, where we basically take a splitter. We've got our compressor for actually compressing with using the large language model. And then we've got our embedding filters so that when we bring it back, we've got something much smaller now. Now, in this case, you can see that, okay, probably this one is not that useful, but we can see that some of the other things we're getting back are going to be, you know, quite smaller context. Now, this is probably a little bit overkill in this particular example, but you can have pipelines that do a whole bunch of stuff. You can have pipelines that sort of filter things, then do the rewrite, then you check with embeddings, you can retrieve from multiple sources with an ensemble, do a filter, do a rewrite, you could even then check embeddings, etc., return it. Retrieve, split them up, check the splits with embeddings, filter it, do a rewrite. So there's a whole bunch of different ideas that you can try with this pipelines idea. And so this is basically just setting up a pipeline compressor where you take some of the things that we've talked about before and start to use them in your actual document retriever pipeline in there. All right, so the contextual compression tasks and filters along with the pipelines themselves are one of the key things for building a really good and useful RAG. Now, you always have to balance the speed if you need it to be real time versus the number of different things you're doing. But if you're doing something like summarization, where you perhaps don't need it to be as real time, you can do quite a number of these things. And you can summarize, you know, custom summarizations based on getting these chunks out. And in that case, you could go for, you know, quite a lot of chunks that get used for answering a particular summarization question, etc. If you are doing sort of real-time question and answering, you want to basically check out your timings of, you know, how long is each of these things taking. And you'll probably build multiple compressor pipelines where you test, you know, doing different kinds of rewrites, different kinds of filtering, different kinds of splitting, etc. The other big thing to remember is don't forget that you can actually rewrite all these particular prompts. So things like this prompt that you've got here, if you prefer to rewrite it for a very specific use case, far too often I see people are building a RAG for a very specific use case, but they're using very generic prompts. There's nothing wrong with honing in your prompts on your specific use case and allowing the language model to know that, okay, you're only interested in things that relate to medical things. You're only interested in, you know, particular types of things, depending on the domain that you're working. All right, I encourage you to play around with this and try out different versions of this for your particular tasks. As always, if you've got any questions, please put them in the comments below. If you found the video useful, please click like and subscribe. I will see you in the next video. Bye for now.